Welcome to Longworth Theater's Symposium, Sunday Symposium Series. Many of your faces are familiar, many of you are also new. We've got a little something new happening with our symposium as well, so if you look to our left, of course, you'll see a banner that you will have never in the 10-year history of our symposium series ever seen, but we're really excited to have it up here. It's part of a grant from Connecticut Humanities and part of a larger initiative on Longworth's part to engage with the greater New Haven community. So they are the sponsors of our symposium series starting here. You'll notice a camera in the background there. Just try and ignore it. We tell all actors. But this will eventually be made available to the general public on our website. So part of the grant is about sort of allowing these events that are often limited to the number of people who can come and sit in our house after a performance to make them available to interested individuals down the road. As I said at the beginning, my name is Eric Ting. I'm the Associate Artistic Director here at Longworth Theater. Can everybody hear me all right?
Yes.
Excellent. I'm going to really quickly introduce, there are bios in the program, that insert there. We'll let you know more about our distinguished guests today, and they are immensely distinguished, so we're really, really honored to have the both of you here today. Thank you. To the far left is playwright Brandon Jacobs Jenkins, and Brandon I've known actually for several years now, and he's just recently had a production of a play of his, several productions of a play of his called Appropriate, sort of take the East Coast and Chicago by storm. It will be opening at the Signature Theater later this year, in January, February. And we can talk more about that, but it'll probably come up at some point. But Brandon is from DC originally. And probably you'll be hearing more from him in the next year or two, I have no doubt. To my immediate left, of course, I would like to think she needs no introduction, but this is Dr. Elizabeth Alexander, poet, teacher, writer, dramatist. She of course is probably most recently distinguished for being asked to give the inaugural poem at Obama's inauguration most recently, and so I hope that's okay if I end with that there. Okay, great, awesome. Again, bios in the program, so take a moment to take a look at those at some point today. Well, I'm going to sort of start us off with a couple questions for you all, and we'll just get the conversation going. I think if there's one thing that we can that we should have no trouble talking about whatsoever, it's the career of August Wilson and certainly his import to not just American theater, but this country as a whole. And I thought I'd just start with this question, which is for both of you, and you take it as you will, but when did you first encounter the works of August Wilson?
I can start. I was born in the 80s, and I sort of encountered him in school ultimately, but I also had an Afrocentric education, which is a little difficult to unpack outside of DC. But you're taught sort of like the canon of African American literature from a very early age, and I remember reading a truncated version of the piano lesson when I was in fifth grade, and then having to do like scenes from it, and we had no idea what we were doing. But. And then my first actual encounter with it was the College Reduction Offenses, actually, about seven years later.
Now that we've discovered that we both grew up in Washington, D.C., I grew up a dab earlier than you did in Washington and did not have an Afrocentric education, though growing up in D.C. is Afrocentric unto itself. Where did you go to school?
I went for elementary school.
Well, where did you have that education?
At Rouse Activity Learning Center.
Oh, interesting.
Okay. Have you heard of it?
I think that's fabulous and generational, which is what interests me. So I first encountered August Wilson in New Haven, Connecticut, when I was a junior in college, and his first produced play, Ma Rainey's Black Bottom, was in development and then production at the Yale Rep. It really was amazing as an undergraduate knowing that something was happening in New Haven, knowing that something was happening on campus. It was a quite beautiful era for the Yale Rep. Athol Fugard, of course, was also producing his plays. People here know about that. And so you would see August Wilson himself around town, and you'd see all these fantastic actors around town, some of whom had ties to the Yale School of Drama, Rock Dutton, Angela Bassett, Courtney Vance, the first Corey, and so forth. But it was amazing to feel it sprouting and growing. And certainly, I don't know at that stage of my life what grand pronouncements I could have made about what was happening in the American theater, but certainly when those people spoke from the first moment the lights came up in Ma Rainey, you knew that we hadn't heard that on stage before and that something extraordinary was beginning. And so from there, the next immersed encounter was with Wilson came many, many, many years later, right after his passing. He had been in New Haven in the spring. Again, I'm sure that many of you went to the first productions of Radio Golf here. And then shortly after that, we found out that he announced extraordinarily to the world that he was terminally ill and that he was at peace because he had done his work. So with Radio Golf, he completed that great cycle century. So he passed away in, I think it was October, and in that spring, I taught a seminar called August Wilson and His Contexts, where we just very methodically went through the plays, had a wonderful symposium where people who had worked with him, actors, designers, people who did all sorts of things, came and talked about him while he was still, sort of think about it in a Wilsonian way, very much in the ether in New Haven. So,
Of course, many of you are probably no stranger to the works of August Wilson, in no small part to his relationship to Lloyd Richards and the Yale rep at Yale. This is actually, however, Longworth Theater's first production of a play by August Wilson, something that we've been sort of pushing really hard to have done for a long time now. And so, welcome to August Wilson, I should say, here at Longworth. Could you talk a little bit about, I'm always curious about these questions, and these are delicate questions for me a little bit, but I'm wondering, so he's best known, of course, for the Pittsburgh Cycle, or the Century Cycle, as you said, which is a series of 10 plays that, in their way, examine the African-American experience during the 20th century in the United States. And he's talked about that, at least in part, as I understand it, as an effort to, at least in some of the plays that take place in the earlier part of the 20th century, to put in front of audiences or to put out there in the world a sense of this experience that was happening that for many people perhaps they didn't realize was happening. It was a sort of invisible experience. It was an experience that was not present certainly in our drama, and maybe even to a greater degree in our popular culture, as visible as perhaps other cultures have been at the time. And what's interesting to me is, at least in part, because it's the Century Cycle, so this is a man writing about the experience in the 20th century. Now that we find ourselves in this new century, sort of, has our relationship to the work of Wilson changed any, do you think? Or is the way that it speaks to our culture changed any? Perhaps even by the fact that, or maybe I should say, has... Okay, this is where it gets delicate, of course, because I know I'm asking a question more to be provocative than anything else, but to what extent has this country's relationship with race evolved or changed since Wilson was writing these plays, and how do they speak to us now? And maybe they don't speak differently in any way at all.
Well, I could start with that enormous, bigger than the building question.
We have 60 minutes.
So I guess I think that when you think about the significant, he was writing plays until relatively recently, so I actually don't think we're in another era. I think we're on a continuum of thinking about these questions, and I think that, he said something very gorgeous about what it meant for him to mine African-Americanness in his work. He said, in writing about the experiences of black people, he said, I'm paraphrasing, when you go there, you will find that the experiences, the black experience, is as wide open as God's closet. That he said, as wide open as God's closet. So, finally America has its Shakespeare, right? Finally the American experience actually has its dramatist who has most fulsomely chronicled Americanness in a very mindful historical way. He is writing out of African-American experience. Black people are at the root of what he's writing. But, look at Fences. I think this is the most produced in a play in the Wilson canon, and it's produced in China, and it's produced all over the globe, because these generational conflicts are so resonant, though they are expressed here in the African American particular.
Yeah, that's a good question. I think you raise a very good point, which is that, like, you know, people forget that August died very early, you know, very tragically, and that his contemporaries are still quite alive and well and in working. And so it's hard to talk about, like, what that conversation would be after him, because again, it is like kind of the spectrum that you feel. And I do believe, though, you know, I think artistically, his kind of major other kind of very public contemporary was Toni Morrison, right? And I think if you go back to these interviews with them, The Height of Their Visibility, which was kind of the early 90s, you see them saying some of the same things, which is that it was a project of, that something about their aesthetic project was about visibility. It's about rendering people who are invisible visible, you know? And I definitely feel like I live very thankfully in the shadow of that kind of visibility. But now I think the question is about, you know, pointing out textures of invisibility and diversity within the visibility, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, sure.
Can I just follow up on something? Because I'm really glad that you brought up Toni Morrison. She's a perfect person to put alongside Wilson, of similar ambition and I think similar greatness. And she too also talks about, you know, kind of growing up speaking from where you stand. Mm-hmm. Speaking from where you stand. But also, when you talk about invisibility, as it happened, I heard her give a talk just the other day at the New York Public Library, where it was quite astonishing. She was talking about Invisible Man, and she said, invisible to whom, is the question she asked. And what she was talking about is, Black people, we are not unknown to ourselves. You know, so what does it mean? And it's a really interesting kind of shifting of thinking about what it means to simultaneously make a diverse experience visible, at the same time that you're not trying to prove or show to anyone that you exist in the first place. And I think that both of them do that so brilliantly.
Yeah, I agree. I think a lot of her, some of her early kind of interviews, if you read them, are all about kind of critiquing this idea of an artist of color whose job it is to explain of colorness to someone of non-color, if that means, you know. And I think that she felt in some way she was responding to that generation. And I think I think August felt connected to the Black Arts Movement, which is you know, which was a get when that generation was about audience indictment in a way and creating a safe space for people of color to actually see themselves on stage, you know. And I think August is after something interestingly more interracial, at least at the tip of his career. I don't know. So I mean, these questions of to whom are very valid all over. I mean, this canon, definitely. If you look at Ma Rainey, I mean, that's sort of the kernel of its thrust. But anyway, visibility.
Does that bring up? So I'm interested a little bit. We talked briefly on the train up, actually, Brandon and I, about this idea of the shadow that his voice casts on artists working today. So as a early career playwright yourself, a playwright of African American descent, sort of, do you find that your work is in any way, shape, or form in dialogue with that? Or what are occasions when you find that the voice of this great writer sort of comes into play in your journey as a writer?
Yeah, I mean, as I said on the train, this is a complicated question because I don't know if I mean, I have a very fraught relationship to August, and, you know, that began in a place of like not understanding and kind of feeling aggressive towards the work, and now I've like come kind of 180, and I think a lot of that's due to just being older, you know. But you know, early in my career, a lot of what I was doing was like responding to August. My first play, Neighbors, was like in some ways dealing with like the August legacy, and I talked openly about it in public, you know. But then, you know, last year I saw the Piano Lesson Revival with the Signature, and it was one of the most, I saw it three times, because there was something, he was Shakespeare, you know, there was a kind of like spell that he cast, just with language alone, you know, issues aside. And even here, you know, I actually have to enter, like, all during fences, all I could think about was how my grandfather was the same age as Lyon. You know, and like, and trying to like place my family history within this time frame was like sort of a real, something came up for me, you know. And yet, like, there's something that something about these family dynamics, like you say, that are actually what stand out strongest from this landscape, and that I identified with somehow. So I think I've come to like study his works as a craftsman. You know, there's something about like what language does when it's repeated. There's something about what it means to locate things and characters. I mean, he's like the king of these arias, these like beautiful character arias. So I'm somehow learning a lot from him as a writer now than I was. Yeah.
I wonder also if I could ask some more about your work. I mean, when you talk about, you know, you put your grandfather is evoked. I think one of the things that he does that's so amazing is that we're in the world of this particular family drama, but we're always on a historical timeline, but very deftly.
Yeah.
You know, so, you know, just the references to before the war, after the war, the desegregation of jobs in the garbage company. You're just placed in history enough to understand how the press of history is always relevant, it's always telling, but we're not always saying, and now it is 1950.
Right, you know. Right. I think part of this project was trying to delineate how history literally shapes life. You know, that so we like to think of history as this kind of object that we're constantly referring to or citing, but actually, like, we live in it, and it affects the way that we love, it affects the way that we deal with each other, it affects our opportunities. I mean, the whole kind of, well, one of the many tragedies of Troy is that he was just too old for baseball, mm-hmm. You know, and that's, like, a thing anyone can understand, mm-hmm. You know.
And has to tell himself other stories, and I don't know, the way that I take it is, no one's exactly right, you know, it's not only that he's too old, you know, race matters, but it doesn't matter as much as he says it matters, but it does matter, and I think that's just very artful as well.
Yeah, I agree.
Well, could I also, in asking about your work? Well, because, yeah, I mean, talking about the 1980s, I am sometimes surprised to think about other African-American playwrights of the 80s and to understand that formally August Wilson actually was really doing things quite differently from George C. Wolfe,
right.
From early years of Susan Laurie Parks,
right.
From Anna Deavere Smith, you know, and thinking from late Adrian Kennedy, you know, the sort of...
Well, they remind me of the modernists, the black modernists and the postmodernists, definitely. I mean, that has a lot to do with George C. Wolfe as kind of another big kind of pry in the canon, right? Because he's actually, his artistic leadership as a public led to the career of Susan Laurie Parks, Angela Stevens, and Robert O'Hare, because we're in today. So, in that, you know, that's its own lineage. But I do think that there was something about August that was, that his investment in naturalism was shocking.
Yes.
And it's not pure naturalism, because there is all kinds of funny, it's very, yeah, like Toni Morrison, it's like the edges of it are kind of mystical, you know? But I think that's why he feels so weirdly sui generis, you know, because mm-hmm. He cites Amir Baraka as his like most major
artistic in the blues,
right? Piece. Exactly. Yeah. But his theater references is Amir Baraka didn't write in the naturalist thing, you know. And then there's also something about him that's just so generous and like and thick and emotional, and it wasn't somehow every emotionalism that it was in his plays. You know, he wanted something broad, and that was, I think, very difficult to be able to do at that time.
And so how, as a playwright, do you encounter that naturalism with its, we could call it supernatural or something else that I call it sometimes, and in some ways I think Fences is the least of the plays, but there's always the penetration of the world of the dead to the world of the living. Mm-hmm. You know, there's always talking across that boundary. So I wonder, as a playwright, as you know, as you start to make plays, how did you think about that naturalism? Did it feel old-fashioned to you? Did it feel like you had to conquer it? How did you come to feel you could use it?
I mean, I was naturally suspicious of naturalism. You know, to think has to do with the fact that when you're young, you don't quite understand that the world is not you. You know, that's part of the. And so getting outside your head is a major part of becoming an artist, I think. And I did, you know, my original feelings about the work of August Wilson is that they were kind of fusty and old-timey, and like everyone's playing blues music, and the parents go to them, you know. But then it's once you start paying attention that you realize that that's when the kind of, this religiosity of these plays, for lack of a better word, kind of creeps in up on you. I actually think this is a very weird play, because in the end, the heavens open, you know, and And it's punctuated by Troy's monologues to death. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, it is very contained, much more so than Piano Lesson or like, what's the
Joe Turner.
Joe Turner, yeah, exactly. Yeah. You know,
but so, on the spectrum.
Yeah. I think that was about, you know, I think that's about the moment in the 70s, it's happened accidentally. I mean, Albert Rapto's Slave Religion, you know, there was an investment in trying to understand how African-Americans relate to the world spiritually, you know, what was the, somehow that was like spiritual emptiness of what everyone was trying to fill up, mm-hmm. you know. And treating the theater as church in some way, I think, was interesting to him, mm-hmm. you know.
The Hill District that Wilson writes about, of course, has a sort of mythic kind of space. It's very specific, but at the same time, it's in its presence in this cycle of plays, it takes on almost a character of its own. It's interesting you're talking about sort of this is in its way the most realistic of this, the most naturalistic of the 10 plays. And I know Felicia early on was sort of like the one sort of bit of guidance that she kept coming back to was sort of looking at August plays, and she always says, do the numbers. When you work on a play by August Wilson, you do the numbers. And one of those things that she was looking at was just the idea of the age of Troy, setting him up as having been born around the time of Gem of the Ocean, which is the play that starts off the century cycle. And so, you know, and I think also when you do research on Wilson, what you find is that the period that Fences is set is like, this is the play. So when he lived in the Hill District, he lived in the Hill District up until really around the mid-50s when he moved. And he moved because his mother remarried, as I understand it, and he left that neighborhood. But that, to the extent that this period of time, the decade that he's writing about, and this specific world is something that would have been extra familiar to him, I think, as an artist and sort of from his own history. Do you find that, well, let me ask this sort of as a poet, to shift now, we're going to interview you for a little bit. Do you find that, you know, you've talked about August Wilson as almost Shakespeare, like Shakespeare, that he is a Shakespeare for America. What is it about his language that strikes you, that makes that connection for you?
I'm so often, to me the test is, am I jealous? And I read the plays and I'm sick. You know, I'm so jealous. Starting with the stage directions, which, you know, in the opening stage directions, if you go and look at the plays and read those, they are these gorgeous, saturated prose poems. And so your question, what about the language, is a great one and a complicated one, because I think he understands very profoundly about the rhythms of great artistic speech that nonetheless occurs very naturally in the day-to-day, and that has achieved with the best of the black talkers, you know, a truly, truly glorious manifestation. You know, black talk at its most beautiful is poetic, is metaphoric. I mean, Portroy, you know? I mean, he is trying, he knows he needs metaphor in his life, he tells us that. I'm trying to talk to you, Rose. I'm trying to tell you a story when she says, I don't want to hear about, you know, all of the metaphors that he tries to use. He knows it's necessary, and I think part of his tragedy is that his language and his life cannot ascend to that level. The Rose's aria, which is, you know, absolutely what it is, at the end, her very, very great monologue, she can't come to until the end, you know, after we hear about all of the ways that she's made herself smaller and contoured her life, not only to the question that's never articulated, what does it mean to be a black woman, a core black woman in this particular place and time, but what does it mean to be Troy's wife? You know, we don't hear that poetry until the end. And I think, and I'm answering your question in a roundabout way and getting to a very direct answer, I think that the final epiphany with the aptly named Gabriel is so important. I've seen it done different ways. I've seen it where the horn does make the sound, and that's the final sound, that's the final utterance. But that finally he has found song, that finally he's fulfilled his purpose, that finally he's taken his brother to the other side. Yeah. is just so extraordinary. But at any rate, I think that what many poets understand, August Wilson started out as a poet who made actual poems. What they understand is that the relationship of breath to utterance, the relationship to how much breath you can hold in the body, has everything to do with the poetic line and with poetic rhythm and poetic syntax. And that's what you see if you go, you can parse all the monologues and scan them gorgeously. I've heard actors talk about how, and I just love this, when we had that symposium at Yale, some of the actors said, oh, because we finally had our Shakespeare, because we could finally speak our language in its most elevated form, they would sometimes go off book because they think it would remind them of their aunt, it would remind them of their grandfather. They'd start speaking that way, but then they always have to be brought back on book to the actual poetics, line by line. And as when an actor trains to read Shakespeare, you know, and you get that in your body, you understand that it's actually totally organic.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. There's also a sort of, so at the same time that you have this kind of elevated lyrical language, there is a remarkable colloquialism around it. And is that what you mean when you, for the benefit of some of the audience, can you go into more detail about what you mean by black talk, specifically, and black talkers?
Or not, it's okay.
No, I'm just trying to think about how to go about it. I mean, there are many different variations on black vernacular, and many different black vernaculars, and many different, well, sometimes, actually, if we really want to go there, you could think about all the different ways the word nigger is used in the play, all the different inflections, all the different colorations it has, which I thought, you know, in kind of the flat and stupid contemporary debates about the word, there's never that understanding that actually, sometimes in context, it can go a lot of different ways, and you see that shift in the play, especially with that confrontation with Troy and his son. But you know, I think the storytelling tradition in African American culture is huge. The use of metaphor is absolutely huge. Associative language, a sense of a relationship to great black music, and again the blues, which so influenced in the storytelling structure of the blues. The way in which we see the song about the dog Blue as a refrain throughout, finally its meaning comes full and clear at the end. I forgot this. You know, he's burying the dog. You know, so those are many of the different colorations.
One thing that I always respond to is the use of repetition, which they don't find anywhere else in American theater. That this sense of, it's not so much what, I mean, content is a part of it, but the language becomes used as, I mean, there's refrains, you know, there, like, I will say a sentence, and I'll talk, and I'll say that sentence again, and every time we return to it, it has a different color to it. Mm-hmm. And that kind of sense of building language out, kind of in pieces, is sort of part of the thrill of it. I mean, also it's about daylight and battle short. It's like,
yes,
pot to piss in, women throw out. I mean, those are kind of like colloquialisms that I grew up around, my family still use it. You know, so it's again, like, it's always tricky when you don't label anything black, but it's a sense of like recognizing those things as coming, growing out of what was once an insular, you know, languages are born within insulated communities, right?
Yeah, those aphorisms are so incredibly important in the Wilson plays.
Right.
Yeah, and once you get going with them, they sent for you yesterday, here you come today.
You're right.
You know, they go on and on, but there's such great poetry.
Right, exactly. Yeah. He winds up setting those outside of the colloquial use of it, they become something else, and they take a minute to hear them mean. And I don't know, it's a different way that I relate to the language, at least. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Do you want to talk perhaps a little bit about Troy, the character of Troy Lanson, and the sort of what he represents, perhaps to you or to the others?
I literally sat there the whole time being like, I hope he doesn't ask you about Troy. Because I can feel, you know, I just feel like every time I walk into an August Wilson play, I think I know what I'm going to get because I've seen it, and then I watch it and I'm like, oh my god, I never heard this thing. you know? And this is the first time where I felt like I heard like Troy's, like that kind of thing for metaphor, like you said, that somehow he just wants so bad for baseball to be a way that life works, you know, and it doesn't, and I asked myself, like, is he, and I was like, maybe Troy just somehow can't deal with consequence, or he's never learned how to digest the idea of consequence, you know, what that can mean. Anyway, let me stop rambling. I think like a lot of Wilson's plays, this may be more specifically than others, I would count Jenny among this as well. It's one of those plays that's dealing with like black masculinity in a very overt way. Like I would argue that something like Piano Lesson was about family in some odd way, and Radio Golf's about politics. But this was definitely about trying to unpack an idea of like black malehood in the mid-century, you know, like just like about a decade or two before Jim Crow was finally lifted, you know, I mean, being in a workforce, we're like in the wake of, I guess we're in the thick of, are we in the thick of the cold, the rest here, I can't remember, mm-hmm. We are, yeah. Yeah, so these questions of labor are becoming very present,
yeah.
You know. And then it ultimately is about like how to actually be, how do you be a man, or how do you become a man in an era when being a man and being a black man was like basically impossible. You know, his story is about like being forced out of his home at 14, and he says he's on the road. He walks 200 miles to the next town. There's nothing there to do. And he says to himself, "I gotta rob somebody." And that is like such a profound thought to me that I can't imagine having to have. But that was his only option. You know, he says like I had to follow my heart. Like my heart is all I had, and I never could ask myself if it was right or wrong, except when it felt right in my heart. You know. And being forced to live off one's instincts in that way seems both the kind of genius of this depiction of Troy, you know?
Yeah, and I think also all of those questions of black masculinity are most obviously played out between Troy and Corey, but are also in all the weavings and pairings of the men in the plays. I mean, that play, I thought particularly in Corey's choice to join the armed forces, and next to the example of Gabe, you know, you just think, this is not like, and then when you bring the history back in, think, this is not going to end well for you. You know, not likely, you know, not likely. But it's an attempt to be a man. It's an attempt to find your way. It's an attempt to be not the father and also not Lyons, who's trying to find his way. And ultimately, tragically, one of the ways his masculinity echoes his father's is that he's incarcerated, though for a shorter period of time. I think that Troy, there's a letter in the Lloyd Richards papers at the Beinecke at Yale from James Earl Jones, the first Troy, to Lloyd Richards, and he says, again, paraphrasing, I can't shake Troy. I'm not happy. I'm still in him. He's still on me. Why is he so hard? Why can't he open his heart for his son? You know, he just can't get him off. His figure is that tragic. And I think he's supremely tragic. So well performed here today also. I just want to say, what a wonderful.
Yeah, I mean, I actually sat here wondering if I would consider him a tragic hero in the classical way, because I don't know what his flaw is. You know, if it's the idea of, right, like all this could have been saved if he understood, like, love, whatever that is, right? If he understood how to make room for someone else in his life, right? Or, I mean, you know, what is the,
what's
where did he go
question?
Wrong,
what's
you know?
Yeah.
And then, yeah, that's what's going to keep us going home and talking about it, you know, but I always think about how, you know, the very famous, one of the many famous scenes in this is the "I don't have to like you" dialogue, which is, you know, performed all over the internet. Like, Google if you want to see 100 versions of it. Yeah, people just use that material all the time. But you know, that moment is an act of love as Troy sees it. You know, isn't that really crazy?
Well, and again, I mean, I thought of, that was when I first thought of Toni Morrison, because again, that's so blackly generational, right? I mean, you know, in Sula, where she's
right.
gonna love you.
Right.
Love you? I kept you alive.
Right.
That was my job, and that was what I could do. That was what I was, that was what there was room for me in this constrained world to do. I kept you alive. And that's really, really profound, and in such a wonderful way, I think, makes us ask about, you know, what is love, what is filial love, what are our parents' obligations to their children. Mm-hmm. It's hard, you know, and it's hard for us as theatergoers enjoying leisure time.
Right.
But it's important.
It's like an internal question. You know, that's like, that's the mystery of family, right?
That's
like,
right.
No one, it doesn't come with a rule book.
Yeah.
Or maybe we
I brought you on this earth, I'll take you out.
Right.
Since we'll let these aphorisms be our friend for today, we'll go back and forth.
I like it.
There's a great quote, actually, just listening to the two of you talk right now from Lloyd Richards' Introduction to Fences, which is, it's about Troy. It says, he learns the day to day and moment to moment. He lives close to death and must wrestle with death to survive. He learns that to take a chance and grab a moment of beauty can crumble the delicate fabric of an intricate value system and leave one desolate and alone. Strength of body and strength of purpose are not enough. Chance and the color of one's skin, chance again, can tip the balance. You've got to take the crooked with the straight.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking a lot more today than we normally are, supposing, because we're now sponsored by the Connecticut Humanities. But no, I hope there's news here from Connecticut Humanities. Hello, this is amazing. Can you talk to us a little bit more about, if you would, you know, when we talk about August Wilson, you know, where does he? You were starting to sort of place him in respect to. I don't want to talk about it as a sort of. Where does the value of his voice lie? I think maybe politically or socially.
In the history of this country.
Not now. Looking sort of on a broader spectrum.
Yeah, that's hard. I mean, he's definitely of a generation that likely had a college education, I would say, or there was a chance that it was a college education. I mean, he, you know, the peak of his career began as like late 80s, early 90s, so we're looking like a Reagan era, like pull up stuff out of bootstraps, sort of treatment of race and commerce, period, much less the arts.
I'm thinking again of other, you know, I'm always surprised when I put him next to his peers, because I think, oh, he was really kind of doing his own thing. So I would think of him alongside Tony Kushner, for example. I mean, a really important peer who is engaging, you know, questions that are as enormous in a more overtly political way, who's engaging everything from the present tense, well, not in all his plays, but in Angels in America and the sequel, the two parts of that play. So it's in the present, looking at the grand sweep of the century, as opposed to Wilson doing it decade by decade. And so I think it's just, you know, there are different ways of having an experience when you go into the theater. Right? And so I think, you know, the ways in which Raisin in the Sun, to me also, you know, for my generation, Raisin in the Sun was the one that was like, ah, that's, you know, that's hokey, that's tired. But the play is so modern,
yeah,
and enduring and amazing. And of course, from the beginning of Fences, you see how Wilson is speaking to Raisin in the Sun, and to, you know, what our dream, and who's speaking to Langston Hughes.
Right.
What are dreams thwarted? What do we do with them? How do we find our way? So this is sort of, you know, rambling around your question a bit.
I mean, I think that also, I mean, bringing that up, you know, Raisin, Fences, play we just saw, is like, I realized, so structurally in conversation with The Death of a Salesman, I would even say that he,
yes,
is like actually responding to it.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah,
and I,
yeah,
wonder if that, I mean, that kind of also gives us a hint as to what was going on. He had an interest in bringing kind of blackness mainstream, whatever that means. I mean, when we think about Adrian King, also it's important, I guess, to note that he wasn't based in New York.
Yes.
You know, so I think that would explain the kind of like hip formalism of someone like Adrian or Susan Laurie or even,
yeah,
George, you know. But he wanted to bring, I mean, black stories to the kind of regions, to the, you know, to regional theaters. And he also was capitalizing on the fact that there was now a significant number of actors who had been trained in these classical ways. You know, he was, I mean, there's a reason why Laurie kept him at Yale, you know, while he was also the dean, because he was, it was about building a new generation of artists to actually have the American theater actually resemble America in some way. You know, so I think that, I mean, just on an economic level, that was, I think, a major import. And today, you still, I mean, people who are literally, the actors who are working today, literally got through their 20s and 30s doing this. Yep. You know, James Earl Jones, I mean, we all know who he is, you know. And I think also, you know, I was telling this story earlier, too, that, like, I lived in Berlin for a bit, and my final time coming back into the States, I was stopped at customs, as one does. And the guy was like, you have a business of pleasure. And I was like, kind of both. And he's like, what do you do for a living? You know, I was like, I'm a player. And he's like, oh, you're trying to be the next August Wilson. You know, but it was kind of amazing because I was like, how do you know who August Wilson is? Like, passport stamper, you know, but there are neurons in his brain dedicated to who August Wilson is. You know, and that is like profound to me.
Yeah.
That is about like, I mean, that's kind of what, that is the import politically.
Yeah.
So,
Can we begin to perhaps open up some questions in the audience? If anyone, I'm going to just invite this now. If anyone in the audience has any questions that you'd like to ask, and maybe I'm going to ask Eliza to run this up to you. So,
please use the mic.
Mary Lee wanted me to ask a question. One of the things that I, looking at as I was watching this play, is thinking at my own family as a Hispanic woman. And it seems to me that you could adapt this play in a place like the Dominican Republic, where baseball is such an important sport, and just change a little bit. And what I would like for you to talk about is how universal the story is, because it applies to the blacks in the US in the 50s, but it also applies to many of the immigrants who have been coming here from a very rigid culture where the man in the house, my father for one, being human, felt that they had to control the children, they had to control the wife, and didn't think anything of having a relationship with another woman. So in that sense, to me, the play really extends to so many different cultures, and I really appreciate that about it.
That's right. One of the reasons I think is I'm saying is because of his specificity, like that he went through specificity to find a person.
Sorry, he was like one of the bees that like Wilson named as a inspiration was Borges.
Yeah, I think your comment, I mean, thank you for giving us the Dominican example, if you will, because the Cuban example, that's really what I was saying earlier about the fact that this play is performed all over the world, and that it is only, I think, the success of universality, I think, only comes when you are strongly rooted in your own particular. I think that's, that artistically, I think that's where you have to start, so deep in the soil, that you get to those eternal verities.
This is definitely a story of American labor practices in the mid-century, you know, and that, and this is a story of class ascension. I mean, he's a working class man. I mean, that the metaphor of him trying to become a driver and not the guy picking up the cans is like so profound in that sense, right? And it's about, he wants his son to just have a skill. You know, and I think that is like the story of any sort of immigrant population, especially in the States, right?
I think also, you know, that moment is a little startling when he says about midway through, when it's about whether or not he's signed the papers to put Gabe in the hospital, you know I can't read.
Right.
You know I can't read. So, you know, what does that mean as far as the culture and how to ascend in it being legible? To someone who's trying to move through and make their way.
Yeah, it's crucial that, you know, Corey chooses military career. I mean, that was like classically the story of military ascension, class ascension in mid-century for minority populations.
I think August Wilson alludes to, again, when he says, this friend says to him, you have it easy, you're driving a truck, and you can only read a newspaper. And he said, no, I'm lonely, I can't read a newspaper. I'm very lonely in this job. But I appreciated tremendously the universality of the play, but also the exquisite descriptions of Black culture. That was very, very meaningful to me, and historically and dramatically, it was just beautiful.
Thank you. I'm kind of interested in the Jim Bono character. We haven't really talked about him at all. And to me, he seems sort of like this alter ego to Troy in many respects. And he seems to be sort of his conscience in many ways. Troy is very self-confident, very self-assured, very much in his own way. And yet, here's this unassuming man who seems to have this tremendous power over him in terms of his ethics. And that he gets him to face Rose, that even after that conversation with Rose, Troy is, and Jim Bono is definitely sort of upset with him for having sort of betrayed his trust. I wonder if you could just sort of talk about that a little bit, because I think he's really a central character as this, you know, the alter ego to Troy.
Yeah, I mean, I think he's a sidekick, definitely, and I feel that I think it's also important to remember that he's part of his origin story. I mean, they met in prison. Mm-hmm. And I think he's actually supposed to be slightly older than mm-hmm. Troy, if I'm right. And that his origin story is that Troy taught me how to actually get my life together. I mean, I think that devotion, I think it's a kind of codependent sort of thing where they're both learning, they're trading life lessons in some way. So I wouldn't disagree with that.
Yeah, and I think Wilson writes that character, the character who sits in that position, extremely well across the place. You know, there's always an opportunity for us to hear how Black men talk to each other, you know, what the language is that they have amongst themselves, what's the poetry that comes out in banter, what, again, is the kind of aphoristic and mother wit that comes out in that back and forth, in that banter. All of the plays have a Bono, as also most of the plays have a Gabriel, a character who is in contact with the other side, with the supernatural, with a kind of a magical realism that goes along with that.
Yeah, and I always wonder, because I actually think Bono is incredibly complicated, because in the end, I always find myself a little surprised that he fell out of touch so easily mm-hmm. with Troy. You know, that it was somehow just a question of they're not on the same truck anymore, so I don't really come over as much as I do. We all play dominoes together while you're doing what you do, you know? So I wonder how vividly we're supposed to invest any kind of moral intelligence into Bono as a person.
Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, the baby is a cataclysmic, right?
Right.
You know, so a lot of things change very dramatically. And a lot of things change, you know, on either side of the fence. You know, so now this fence that Troy has been trying to build in order to keep his family in, well, he can't keep his family in. His son is gone, his wife is gone. We see her exiting out that gate. She has given herself over. She says, you are now a womanless man. That's it, it's declared, she's clear. And so she and that baby and that cake are down at the church and are no longer of the house in the same kind of way. And similarly, I mean, we don't hear as much about it, but is it because of Lucille? You know, whatever it is, but there is a break at that moment with Bono as well.
Yeah. I should say, actually, two things I discovered for the first time in this play for myself today, based on Felicia's wonderful direction. I never grasped how he, you know, when she finally does leave and goes to church, mm-hmm. he feels trapped. The fences are like, he's pinned in. Mm-hmm. I never noticed that before mm-hmm. until, and also the fact that the fence gets finished before that scene, mm-hmm. and you feel like somehow the fence was built out of guilt or something. You know, he sped it up because he felt so bad, you know, giving her the only thing she wanted.
And I also couldn't remember, having again read and thought about the play a lot of times over the years, but not for a while, early in the play, I thought, oh, he's never going to finish that fence. That's the point.
Right.
He'll never finish it. And he does finish it, but it doesn't do what he hopes it will do.
He feels like he's trapped.
Yeah.
All right. I guess we have time for one last question, if somebody has one. Okay. One last question over here on the...
Thank you so much. I'd love to hear your thoughts more about Rose and her role as the only woman in the play and what she represents to the men as a representative of African American women in the play, and then also the little girl that represents a new generation of females as well. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, I wonder, I would love to hear, this might be something that Eric can speak about, something about also Felicia Rashad's direction. August Wilson is not known as a playwright who writes for women, and for a long time was never directed by women, though he's been directed by a few women, Sorette Scott, some others, but not a lot. So that's a thing that Felicia Rashad was directing it. And I think that, I'm trying to remember the name of the protagonist in The Piano Lesson.
Wow.
But at any rate, that's a...
Rosamund's character. Bernice.
Bernice, yes, that would be Raising in the Sun.
Yes.
But so, I mean, I think that Rose is certainly thought of as his greatest, his most fulsome female character. He's criticized the character whose name I also remember in Two Trains Running, the waitress with the scars on her legs. Yeah, that she also is a woman who sort of has more symbolic impact, but it's not really a fully fleshed role. So I think, you know, Rose is unusual, and I think that everything kind of depends on that final aria. You know, I mean, we wait and wait and wait, and I don't think he's making universal statements about African-American women, but we wait and wait and wait, and then finally we hear the who and the why of her in that final scene. I think also there's an interesting mirroring with the brusqueness with which she speaks to Raynell, the shaping directiveness that you see, well, this is what we try to do with our children. Has it run amok with Troy and Corey? Is that what you need to do to have a bit of brusqueness, to have your children call you ma'am and sir? You know, yes ma'am, and all of Troy's asking Corey to say, where's the sir, where's the sir, where's the sir? It's similar parenting, but it doesn't feel that it's quite gone awry. So I think that there's also something outside the ending of the play that we're left to think about when we leave, about what will happen in that relationship.
Yeah, and I think you talked a bit earlier about like August's chess pieces, and his plays all famously have one kind of major female role, occasionally like a minor second. And he was open about, that was a huge criticism launched at him, mm-hmm. his whole career was his treatment of female characters, and he was very openly like, I'm writing from the place I know.
Mm-hmm.
And he was always encouraging actually to female playwrights to tell what they thought was, if they thought there was a need to respond in some way. Also, I think Rose is, I mean, that material for Rose is, I mean, it, as a playwright, it is, you dream mm-hmm. of being able to channel some of the stuff that he gets out of her. And that is, and I would argue this is the strongest material he has for a woman mm-hmm. in all, across all of his, mm-hmm. all of his plays, you know. And really, you know, any kind of emotion you're feeling about that baby or anything that happens, it, like, all that actually begins, I'm talking about in terms of crap, begins with her monologue.
Yeah.
You know, everything you feel in that second act is all, it all it gets the ball rolling because she comes out and says, you're telling me this now?
Yeah.
You know, and that's pretty powerful stuff.
This is
the play where, like, Wilson would have been Corey's age, or in the vicinity of Corey's age.
There's a little bit of that.
You know what, I'm going to take this time actually now to thank both of you, Elizabeth and Ben. So
thank you all. We'll see you next time.